Hello, good afternoon everybody. I hope I am audible and people are able to see the PPT which I have shared with you. Okay. Let me first explain the focus of today's webinar. In this particular webinar, I am mainly going to focus on some simple inbuilt features which are available in almost all the popular RDBMSes, which can be used very efficiently to improve on basically your data security. And as far as possible, I am trying to focus only on the features which are very common, something like simple views, procedures, functions, and not so-called high-funda features like VPD or database vault or level security. So let's begin our journey. Let's first understand, when we talk of database security, what do we mean by database security tasks? And here on the screen, basically I'm sharing a list of all the categories of tasks which are coming to people's mind or which are expected to be done the moment we talk of database security. And some of the tasks will be, it will basically start with secure installation and configuration, which refers to obviously configuring all the different initialization parameters. Then patch management, then the next thing is like password policies, making sure the default accounts are deactivated if not in use, changing the default passwords and things like that. Now all these tasks, when you consider, more or less they are a part of something which we call as typically, mostly it is related to server hardening. Now apart from these tasks, which are more or less stereotype I would say, because once you finalize on the software which you are going to use, there are n number of guidelines available in the forums as well as given by the vendor on all these aspects of your database hardening or improving on your database security. And evaluation of this is comparatively easy because one can easily write either a homegrown script for checking all these kind of settings, as well as there are many products available in the market which cater to the need of finding out how secure are all these aspects of your database, which are more or less related to all your server settings. Now is this all when we talk of database security? The answer is no. Apart from this, this is just half the part. Apart from this, the other half is related to your actual business schema. And the business schema and backend functionality hardening. Now what do I mean by business schema basically? These are the set of tables which typically cater to the need of your business, where the business required inputs and outputs are stored, and any operations related to your business which pertain to your data operations, those which are very complex or peculiar, for those we may write some backend functions. Functionalities like procedures, functions. Some of the softwares will allow you to have package procedures, functions. Then there is something which is a specialty of database functionality, which is a trigger. So all these functionalities which are developed essentially in PLSQL, as well as the set of tables which cater to the need of your business. This is the something which is scenario specific. And this is something which is equally important as your server hardening or your network connection hardening. And here all these inbuilt tools or any third party tools or scripts will really not help you when you move on from one database schema to other database schema, because each schema is unique which caters to that particular business. So unless and until this schema is hardened properly, that is access control for this particular schema objects is maintained properly, you cannot say your database is secure. So basically focus of our today's session is on this particular aspect, which is well known. All these things we learn when we learn basics of database programming, but then I don't know, most of the times this is the most neglected aspect. So I thought it is worth bringing the focus on this, taking opportunity of this particular webinar. So let's have one look at the various top database threats. If you look at most of the threats in the beginning, say excessive privilege abuse or legitimate privilege abuse or privilege elevation, most of this is achieved through a very popular database threat which is known as SQL injection. Now there are so many cases of data breach, and most of the times when we look at the details, we find that some way or other some kind of SQL injection was posed, which led to one of these which we have listed down in the beginning. That is basically gaining access to the data which was not supposed to be available to the particular user. Now what is the reason? The reason of this is the typical philosophy which is used in implementation of all our projects. Now let's have a closer look at this threat which is called as SQL injection. Basically, what is our SQL injection? When we talk of SQL injection, it is actually what is happening is your application form has got some text fields which accept some kind of user input, and instead of putting the appropriate values for those user inputs, the hacker basically tries to put in some kind of a command where the SQL engine is fooled into believing that that is a legitimate command, and it executes, giving rise to either unwanted illegal modification of data or maybe revealing the data which is not expected to be made available to that particular user. Now how does it happen? This is the most general kind of architecture which we can have a look at. Here is the client's machine. In the browser on this client machine is the typical web form in which there are fields for putting in the user input, there are drop down lists, there are menus, and there are buttons. So basically the hacker, through the set of the text fields which are made available, instead of legitimate input values, tries to pose in some commands. After clicking a menu or a button, all this information is passed on to the web server, which in turn passes it on to the application server, and the application server is responsible for validating those user inputs, then pose an SQL query, and that is passed on to your database server, which is supposed to be very secure behind the firewall. This is how the typical architecture is. And the overall philosophy is that all this kind of validations and access control of data should be taken care of basically by your application server component, this particular component, whereas once you have hardened your server and configured all your networks, made sure all the communication is encrypted and things like that, apart from that, rest of the access control or typically data authorization, that is data access rights and data modification rights, should be taken care of by this application layer and not by the database server. Now typically This is the cause of SQL injection in most of the cases. Moment your application server is hacked, manipulated, or in your input validations there is a flaw, your database has got no defense against the attacker. Now how do we take care of this? Okay, we have to secure our applications and there has to be appropriate validation at the application server level to ensure that the user entered values are right. And here we are not checking only from the security point of view, we are also considering the correctness of the data from the business relevance point of view. So that has to be there in the application server, but no harm in having one more level of defense at database server. And typically here the approach not only makes your data more secure, surprisingly this is one of the rare occasions where security and your efficiency go hand in hand. It will not only make your data more secure, it will also most of the times improve the efficiency of your data operations. Now let's have a closer look at it. When we talk of authorization in a database, there are again two distinct categories, because there are two categories of resources. Number one resource is the operations. Okay, now it involves the various kind of actions which you can perform, like creation of objects, modification of objects, or using the system resources like your various memory components and your CPU. Now this is mostly taken care of as a part of our server hardening, most of the time implemented by using appropriate user policies or group policies. The other important resource in a database is the data itself, and the operations which are performed on this particular data, like insert, update, delete, that is basically changing the data, and retrieval of the data, which is the select. Now we are going to concentrate on authorization related to this data, that is insert, update, delete, and select of data. Now for this particular operation, what are methods of authorization are available with us? Profile based authorization, like just now I discussed, more or less caters to authorization related to the system resources and not your data operations. So for data operations, what is there at our disposal is SQL based authorization related to objects, which is achieved by your grant and revoke commands. You can make it easy for the data administrator. I said data administrator, not database administrator. These two are essentially different tasks and most of the times are performed by different people. So when you are talking of a data administrator, this is the person who is responsible to devise appropriate authorization model for your particular business schema. So your data administrator can basically improve on his task efficiency by allocating these grants to a role or a group, or in some softwares these two are separate concepts, to both, so that your overhead of granting these to individual users is reduced. All you have to do is grant these permissions to the group or a role or both, and associate a user with that particular group or role, or sometimes both, and then there is a hierarchy. So role based authorization is nothing but administration wise simplified version of your grant and revoke, Of course, it can be made more secure by putting role activation passwords and things like that. But essentially, it caters to the same kind of operation. Only your administrative overhead is reduced. Then we have something which is called as view-based authorization, program-based authorization, which we are going to discuss in detail now. And then, of course, there are some high-end features which are made available by several vendors, like level security, database vault, virtual private database, which may be inbuilt, which may be paid plugin, which may not be available in some softwares, or the way they are implemented or the syntaxes may differ from one vendor to other. Now, let us first understand this SQL injection thing in detail with the help of an example, and then we would realize why basically this authorization is important and will be helpful in protecting our data from any kind of SQL injection attack in case our application server or front-end applications are manipulated. So I am moving on to the SQL console. Here basically to show you an example of the SQL injection attack. We will be using a sample schema from Oracle database, which is a Scott schema. And the schema has got one table named EMP1. Now this table has got columns like employee number, name, job, manager, hire date, some salary, commission, department number, and it also has got the address and email columns for that employee. Now there is some data in this table. Now let's consider this employee one table basically consists of the data of the employees of that organization, and the organization has got some inbuilt portal, okay, some kind of a portal built specially to cater to their needs, which is the front end form, which is made available to these employees, and basically they are allowed to access certain data about themselves and modify certain data like address or email about themselves through this portal form. Now this portal form in turn, just like we had seen the typical architecture, so here on the employee machine lies the form, which in turn connects to the corresponding web server. The application server takes care of the validation, and in your database server is somewhere this employee schema, which I mean this Scott schema, which has got this EMP1 table. Okay, so basically the employee is allowed to change the address and email. Okay, and for this in the form there are two text fields which will be filled in, because you have to keep it open. The employee will be giving the new mail ID or new address, and may probably will click on save or change address or change email button, and in turn the code inside the front end will pose some kind of an update query which is fired on this EMP1 table in the back end. Right now, in order to save on time, what I'll be doing is, instead of showing you the query bin fired through front end, we are going to fire the corresponding thing through back end using a PLSQL code. Now, I hope people can see this code clearly. So here basically I have written some code which is accepting the values from the user. So essentially on your application server, by using whatever is the programming language, there will be some code written inside, and these values of table name, value 1, column 2, value 2, this will be actually coming in from your form text fields, which will be captured, and then it will be formulating a query, SQL query, which is fired on the backend table, right? This is how the thing will be. Now, if we try to execute this particular query, which is very common in your front-end applications, then we can see that, see here, as per what we discussed earlier, we have seen that basically the philosophy is all these kind of validation and access control is to be taken care of by your application server. And once the bare minimum security settings are done, which is actually a part of your server hardening, then there is no other defense on the back end in case the front end defense fails. So basically we will have an example here. This is the query which is fired by the front end, say, and the inputs which are passed on by the user, actually this is a facility to change either your address, see we had seen the table design, either your address or email, for which you have to put in what you want to change and you have to give the new value of the address or your email. Now instead of passing on the corresponding details which are legitimate, let's say here, instead of passing on the corresponding legitimate details, that is here for that specific employee, I want to change my address and I give my new address. Here my employee number basically is, I have taken a very small toy example. So employee number is supposed to be for validation. And instead of giving the appropriate value, basically say I try to bypass this check by giving something like this. Okay. I say I'm allowed to change actually only my address and email, but I try to change my salary. Rather salary for everybody here, because you see here the condition I have given is 1 is equal to 1. Which will be embedded in the where clause. So basically it will happen for all the rows. Okay. And now if I fire, say, the select query, can you see? All the salaries are modified. I will just cancel this change for our further thing. So basically this is how your SQL injection takes place. Now how do we resolve this and still not let our query execution efficiency get affected? The solution is simple. We would go back to this authorization methods now. The key is never share, first of all, never share your owner schema, that is the schema in which all the set of tables are there having the business data. Never share the owner schema credentials to front-end applications for connecting to database. They should not be connecting to the database as the owner user. Okay. So what basically we should do? We should basically request our database administrator to create a separate user. Okay? To create a separate user. Here, I have summarized the corresponding things. So basically, request your DBA to create a separate user. Now, some of the softwares are having the concept of schema, which is a set of tables catering to business needs, which are the logical lockers, and you can associate one or more users with the schema. Whereas some other vendor softwares have this concept that your user and your schema is one as the same thing. For example, in Oracle, your schema and your user are actually the same thing. Okay? In that case, we would create a dummy user who will not have any objects, any data in the particular schema. Okay? So basically request your database administrator to create a dummy user like this. Now here I have for demonstration already created a user named app1. Then put in little more efforts from your side. First of all, find out what all operations need to be performed by your front-end firms on the data. What kind of data retrieval is needed? What kind of insert, updates and deletes? Once you get the information, write the corresponding functionality in your owner schema. Say for example, for our current discussion, the need is you want to give the employees right to modify their address as well as email ID. Okay, but not to modify any other column like salary, commission, either for themselves or for any other user. Okay, then in that case, what we can do is we can basically write a function in the owning schema, something like this, which accepts. Now for here, the validation, the employee number is taken. So that is one of the parameter. Then what field needs to be changed and its new value, right? So my function takes these three input parameters and what it is returning is just a true or false flag. Okay? Now inside this function, first of all, I put in from the database side the validation checks. Now please understand, here I did not increase on the execution time by putting in the validation checks for correctness of data, because that I can rely on my front end. Okay? If my front end is doing that, then I need not spend time again on making sure that the data is correct. Okay? What I'm looking for is a probable SQL injection attack, and it is worth writing some validation code for mitigating, blocking this SQL injection attack. Now I have put in only two validation examples which are very very simple. This employee number of mine, I expect it to be a number, right? I expect it to be a number. But most of the times, even in your table, you don't put it as a number, because basically if you put it as a number, any leading zeros will be trimmed. So those leading zeros which are meaningful, I want to retain. I will have to make it a text field, right? That is varchar 2 or varchar or string or something. Depends on what is your software, right? So here I use a simple function to actually convert it to number, okay, and try to put it in one local variable which is a number. Now if at all here the hacker has put in some additional thing by concatenating, see it's a text field, so by concatenating, if the hacker has tried to put in some additional things like some additional command or has put in the keyword or and put in some condition which will be always true to bypass the validation check, that is to bypass the where condition, then here itself it will give rise to an error, and in the error handling routine I'm just returning a false flag. I'm not telling any details to the hacker, to the front end basically, because then front end may by mistake display those details to the hacker and the hacker may get some additional info and capitalize, and next time when poses the attack, it may go through. So it basically is returning just a false flag to the front end, right? The second validation is again very simple, very trivial. It is checking this P field, okay? This P val is supposed to be the new address or new mail ID. Now suppose again an SQL injection attack has been posed, then here there is one very simple example. This being Oracle code, the concatenation operator is double vertical bar. There is no reason why in your address you should have double vertical bar, right? So if at all double vertical bar is found in this P value, then I know that this is a malicious input. I am raising an error, thereby not going to further operations. And again in my error handling routine, I am just returning a false flag to the front end, indicating the operation cannot be done. Okay, now we can make it more sophisticated check by adding so many things. And in the exception handling, we can also put in additional actions like finding out what is the IP from where the hacker is connected or any other category of things, right? Any relevant additional actions we can take care of in the exception handling routine. Now further, I am making the thing secure by this thing. See, what they are allowed to do, change only address and email. If it is anything else, I'm a legitimate user, I put in my employee number correct, but then instead of, I'm not posing any SQL injection attack, but I'm trying to alleviate my privileges that instead of passing on address, I'm passing on salary and trying to modify my salary. Then in that case, again the operation will not take place. It is going to return false. So basically, by writing a function, I'm restricting what the front-end application can do. And it cannot do anything, even if it is manipulated. Even if your front-end is manipulated, it cannot do anything beyond what this function can do. Now I make things further secure. I don't let this function code be seen by the front-end by any chance. Okay? So I will not create this function in the schema which is allowed for the front-end application. What I will do, I will create this in our owner schema and then grant only execute privilege on this particular function to this application user schema or application user, right? I will grant only execute on this. Further, why should I disclose to this application user whose function this is? Because thereby it would know which is the owner schema, that is the username is known for the database, have the work is done. So I would hide that by requesting the DBA to create a public synonym for this particular function belonging to Scott schema. See, any objects which don't belong to your schema you want to access, you have to append the corresponding schema name with it, right? So basically for this whole thing, I'll get a public synonym created by the DBA, or will ask the DBA to grant rights to create a public synonym to this owning schema. And now, how my front-end application code is going to change with all this? Now my front-end application code will change. Now it is not going to pose any kind of update query. What it is expected to do? It is just expected to give a call to this function. And what it knows is this global synonym name which is given for the function, which it just changes, which gives no idea about what is the original function name, what is the owning schema for the function, whether what the function is doing. Basically, this user application 1 is just given execute privilege, so cannot see or modify the code of this function which is known to him with the name changes. actual function name is something else. Actual function name is f change details, right? F change dt. But then what is the name which is known to my front end? Name which is known to my front end is changes. And what front end can do? Front end can just give a call to this. Now through front end, instead of this particular format, there will be execute, okay, where whatever the function is returning will be taken in either a boolean variable, or maybe if the corresponding front end doesn't permit boolean, then you will have to change your function slightly and have some kind of convention of returning 0, 1, 2, 3 like that, right? So now what my front end is doing, front end is just calling this function. Now let's try it again. Now this time we are not trying it through the owner user. We have got here another user who is the app one. If I try to see what is there in this particular schema, there is nothing. This is an empty thing, dummy user. Okay, this is a dummy user or a dummy schema. Now actually in SQL Server I can just create a user who is just given execute privilege on that, whereas this being Oracle, schema and user are equivalent, they are the same. That's why I created this dummy user who does not have anything. Now your front end is connecting via this user and is basically posing this kind of a command, right, which is execution of this particular function which is known to the front end with the name changes. And basically front end has no clue what is the actual name, whether this is the function and things like that, right? Now let's say again I pose this particular malicious input. That is, I try to bypass the condition. I don't know what is the valid employee number, so I just try to bypass the condition. Okay, then I try to modify the salary, which is actually not allowed. See, all it shows is invalid input values. I try again. This time I try to give a legitimate value. Okay, I try to give a legitimate value, say one of the existing values. 7521 is one of the existing values. So say I am actually an employee, so I give my employee number which is 7521, but then I am not allowed to change my salary, and I try to modify my salary. Again it is saying invalid input values, right? So this is how, by putting in little more effort and devising appropriate authorization, by devising appropriate authorization, I can mitigate the SQL injection attack very successfully. Now there are several variations to this. Basically we can restrict the view of the front end by using the same thing. Say we can have some this kind of a code. Instead of giving a select privilege to this app one user, which is the front end connection user, I can create a view to restrict what the front end user can see from my data globally on this view, right? If your front end is just willing to retrieve data, then view may be a good option. If your front end is trying to modify data, then a procedure or a function in the back end will be a good option. Just create a procedure or function and let the application user just have execute privilege. If the front end is trying to retrieve a data, then create a view with the restricted rows as well as columns, and grant appropriate rights on the view to the application user. So the view will be restricted to only that. Of course you can have further variations in this. Instead of creating a view and returning, you may write a function which returns. Most of the modern RDBMSs allow you to have complex user-defined data types and collections of user-defined data types. So your function can return that complex data type or a collection of complex data types to the front end, which can be mapped easily to the front end class design or front end XML formats, and return the data also via a function instead of creating a view. Or you may want to restrict the operations on your data like update, etc., by taking help of a view and an instead of trigger. Or you can use a combination of procedure or function, view instead of trigger, or your normal DML trigger on a table, that is a trigger which is written on insert, update and delete operations of a particular table. But keep in mind, when we are using a trigger, there is always a performance penalty. So as far as possible, try to restrict to using a view and giving permission on that view to a separate user, or achieving the task by a procedure or a function in the backend. So this particular thing is called as our program-based authorization. Now let's quickly revise the things which we were discussing earlier related to authorization. With this example, now we have understood why it is important on the database side to have proper authorization, irrespective of the kind of authorization which is controlled by your front ends. We realize the restriction on SQL grant and revoke is that, okay, still segregating the application user, that is the front-end user, from the owner schema will help us to restrict only certain operations. But then essentially those will be for your entire table, so you can achieve a granular level by using view-based authorization. And we have seen an example how very simple program-based authorization can improve on our authorization control and in turn grant more security to our data, even in the events when our front-end operations or front-end servers are manipulated. This is a very, very effective technique for blocking your SQL injection attack. And we are not using any hyphen-DA features like virtual private database or label security or database vault. Of course, label security and database vault cater to a slightly different need, that is protecting data from privileged database users. But then instead of using virtual private database, which is not only a penalty in terms of cost, but also in terms of your execution efficiency, this is something which is very much available and simpler, and not only it will improve on the security, but it will also improve on your efficiency, because instead of posing a query from front end, getting the details, then posing a query to modify the data, let all these operations be handled at back end. Those will be happening very efficiently as compared to this frequent communication between front end and back end, and they will be carried out in more secure manner as well. So basically, let's summarize whatever we have learned so far in this small brief session. Basically, we need to implement principle of least privileges, separation of duties and encapsulation. Principle of least privileges, that is basically your strategy should be that of a miser. Never allow your front ends to connect to the owner schema. Always create a dummy user, okay, and grant only the bare minimum required rights to this dummy application user which is created on your database. This will also bring in the separation of duties. Your owner is something else. your operations execute, that is your functions procedures execute with owner's privilege, and this application user has only execute privilege on this functions procedures, so cannot even modify the code of this functions procedures or see it, is restricted by only what your functionality can do. Okay, so basically restrict your application user view as well as the operations the application user can perform. Use appropriate encapsulation approach. See, this is basically, we should be all inspired by this hotels. They never tell us what are the actual ingredients, right? They just serve us the ready food. Similarly, your front end should be served the ready result. Now, it is none of front end business whether it is coming from a table name EMP1 or it is coming from three different tables. What are my actual column names? What are the column data types, sizes, etc. is none of front end business. All this you can very well encapsulate into these kind of routines which you can create on your owner schema, and you can purposely put in altogether different names for the parameters. You may add dummy parameters. As a parameter, some value is passed which you process, perform some arithmetic or logical operations on it, and then actually process some table. Okay, your front end is thinking it's a single table on which it is passing on the data. Inside, your functionality is actually firing insert queries on different tables with altogether different names, different column names, and different column data types and sizes. All this is kind of encapsulation is very much possible when we basically adopt this approach, that as far as possible, no SQL query through front end. Front end will just call my back end functionalities. Then the simple feature which is available in almost all databases, which is a view, is really very useful for achieving fine grained access control over your table data. Instead of granting privileges on the table, which has to be essentially granted for all rows, if not for all columns, you please create an appropriate view which may be taking data from multiple tables, okay, and grant access to the view and not to the tables themselves. Now, it's not necessary that we always use the view approach when we are trying to retrieve data, or sometimes you may want to modify some data and then get back some data based on that. In that case, yes, this is precisely the reason why user defined data types or any kind of collections or XML data types are provided into our relational databases. No one uses them in your basic table column data types because that brings down your efficiency. It is precisely to cater to these kind of needs that these special data types are made available. So let your function return the result by making use of the appropriate these kind of special data types if required, as well as the collections. That will bring in more security and most of the times more efficiency, unless and until your collection population is taking too much time. In that case, you can shift back to the view approach. And please hide all these details by using column aliases in your view definition and synonyms for any of these objects like views, procedures, functions, package procedures and package functions which you are creating. Okay, so these are some of the very simple things. And finally, we have to review all our object accesses very regularly. What rights are given to which user on which data objects and which functionalities which are in turn processing which data, right? So a regular review and limiting is also equally important, and most of the times here our ready-made tools will help us, because a tool would not know what is going to be the corresponding table name or the usernames or what all kind of business content applications are there for which one or more what dummy users are created, right? So here it requires basically more effort on our side to first of all implement this. See, it is obvious, if I allow my front end to directly access my owner schema, I don't have to create these kind of additional functionalities or things like views, which will reduce my development time. But then it is always worth that you spend some more time on these kind of things to improve on your security, right? Now basically I have finished the things which I wanted to discuss. Let's now switch over to the question and answers. Thanks a lot for listening. In case you have any queries, please pass on those. Okay, I will first read out the question. What is the performance penalty in using triggers? Basically, performance penalty in using triggers is, say I have, for example, on my EMP1 table, for any kind of update operation, I have written a trigger. Then moment any update query is fired on that particular table, this particular trigger functionality is to auto execute. So moment I create a trigger, there is always a process running in the background monitoring for this particular update event of this table. Okay, now this process to run is going to take some system resources like RAM, which is the same resource essentially that is used by all my user fired processes. So that way my processes would slow down. That is the first penalty. Secondly, all execution time taken by this trigger is added to the execution time of my update query, and hence the total response time for the update query would increase drastically. So this is the performance penalty as far as triggers are concerned. So as far as possible, we try to fit our secure implementation in procedures and functions. Okay, then there is a question, can we use PLSQL for performance tuning? Yes, definitely. There are several means, though this is not an appropriate place to discuss those. We can definitely use PLSQL for performance tuning. Now we just had a glimpse related to security implementations. See, definitely even when you are putting in the, your primary reason of putting in the procedure or a function, say the function which we saw here, is security, that will definitely execute your query faster because it is happening at the back end itself. You don't have to grant any additional permissions because the functionality is expected to execute with owner's privilege, and there are no back and forth request and response trips between your front end and back end. That is reduced. So yes, it is improving the performance in that respect. Apart from that, we also make use of PLSQL for several other things like common data we put in temporary tables or any kind of cursors or things like that and use. But that is an altogether different angle. Is there any way to protect database schema table definition? Yes, to protect database schema table definition, in the sense, modification of it will not happen unless and until the user has got alter table right or alter any table right. Now, if it is a owner schema, then yes, there is a possibility, because by default here, owner gets all the rights on the objects. But if we use this approach that we create a dummy user, then obviously the user does not have any alter trigger. So even if somebody poses an SQL injection to alter the table, it will not happen. How efficient will it be in using the triggers that for function and procedures? See, basically, trigger, if it is, unless or until you are trying to use a common thing for viewing the data as well as updation of data, then in that case, I will have to use a view, and to cater to the updation need, I will have to take care of that by making use of an instead of trigger. Unless and until some such special need is there, instead of using a trigger, it is always better to use a procedure or a function. Basically, function becomes convenient to return something like a confirmation of flag, like the one which we had seen. And almost all kind of restrictions you can put by the functions. First of all, thanks for your, okay. If we create primary key, it has the behavior of both not null and uniqueness. Even though it has the behavior of not null, why it is accepting a not null constraint? Maruti, basically, I'm not very sure as to what you are trying to ask. Is the question about redundant constraints? Then, of course, it is a flaw in the implementation of the software, that of course my primary key is including the not null constraint. Then the same should not be repeated. Most of the softwares take care of this kind of redundant conditions. Say, for example, when you are creating indexes, the newer versions in most of the software make sure that you don't create redundant indexes to those which are created by default and things like that. So basically, this I would say is incapability on the software side to detect the redundancies in the constraints. As far as why two separate constraints are available, it's obvious that sometimes we may not want uniqueness. Okay, Ravi Kumar is asking how we can find last timestamp of any record updated on the table if table does not have any timestamp column. Ravi Kumar, basically timestamp is a column which is an inbuilt column. We do not have to create it. And most of the time by querying, you can find it out. If not you, definitely the privileged users, it depends basically what all rights are given to the particular user, but privileged user definitely can find about it through data dictionary views. Here the query says, I am new to PLSQL programming, which book or resources, Scott Urman's book on PLSQL is, we would say, like a Bible, so maybe useful to you. What is the difference between data fix script and a procedure? As far as operations are concerned, more or less they are same. Only a procedure can be any kind of execution code, whereas your data fix is more or less related to the particular kind of validations or modifications. That is what I mean. Without giving much details at the core, I would say that is what it is. As you say, a dummy user, what privileges will he have? But if the user is trying to change some details, say salary, can he do that? The user is trying to change his details using website. Okay. Dummy user is basically create an additional user who is not a owner of the set of those tables in your business schema. A third party user, this user should be given bare minimum privilege. Say in our case, if the example we discussed, the user will have just create session privilege to connect to the database and execute privilege on that function which we created. No other privilege is basically needed for the user, because the user is not expected to create any objects and things like that in his logical locker. And basically what the user can do is dependent on what privileges we have given. Say for example, here if we have just given execute privilege on the function, the user can only execute the function and hence is restricted to what the function can do. Can in an Oracle database a single user own more than one schema? No. In an Oracle database, basically a user and schema are equivalent. There is no segregation. You can, however, grant privileges on objects belonging to other schemas to a particular user. So that is how you can cater to the need if you are having a separate kind of schemas, business schemas, and a particular schema user needs to access some other tables or perform some modifications on the tables. Is it advisable to make a trigger work inside a function DML operations? Advisable to make a trigger work inside a function DML operations? See, whether it is a DML fired by a function or directly an update command fired on the console or an update command which has come from front end, as far as the trigger is concerned, the penalty is the same. So as far as possible, we try to avoid using triggers. Of course, certain operations, if you cannot manage otherwise, then that is what we will have to use. If we create a public synonym in a user, why it will be created under the super user, not in a normal user? Basically, public synonym is something that the name will be common, means open, known to all the users of that particular database, or in certain cases, all the corresponding set of databases. Hence, by default, this kind of privileges are not given to the owner users or owner schema or the business schema owners. So basically it is a call from the DBA side, looking at the administrative overheads, whether he creates the requested public synonyms for the specific objects belonging to a specific schema, or whether he gives those privileges to that user and the user creates, I mean the owner, schema owner creates the corresponding synonyms. When we ship a bundle package containing tables as well, then how to assure that these table definitions don't get changed? Are you asking about this, Atul? I don't know whether you're asking about the standard modes of passing on the corresponding package definitions or the table definitions. Then here, whatever are your dump files, basically you can add some kind of a hashing to them and verify that they are not modified before you import them. Other means maybe the corresponding timestamps. You may check after regenerating those whether the timestamps match with your original source database. What all points are to be kept in mind for a database tester? Basically, for a database tester, I believe apart from security, you have to also concentrate equally on the efficiency part of it. Since this is for security, I'll focus only on that. First is checking about the server hardening aspect of it. That is, how secure are your network connections, what all ports are open and what all protocols are allowed and what all IPs are allowed and things like that, which are more or less stereotyped. And you would get n number of guidelines. As far as the schema hardening and backend functionality, data functionality hardening is concerned, any tester has to spend first time to understand the schema as well as functional design. What kind of applications are using what kind of data from which tables and posing what kind of operations on this data, and then look at the overall model to see whether it satisfies all those three requirements, that is principle of this privileges, segregation of the duties, and the corresponding logging of the important operations or operations on the sensitive data. How we can tune my table that has large data to cut my query execution time? Your table is large and you want to cut down on your query execution time. Now basically, Anup, there is no generic answer to this question. It depends on several factors, like whether your queries most of the times are aimed at a particular range of data. In that case, using a partitioning may be an option which will help you to improve on your query performance. Then other option is, I mean, it will also depend on how your query is formulated. So it's true that we have cost-based optimizer, but then we have to also understand that this cost-based optimizer will evaluate only certain number of query plans in the restricted time, and then out of those plans will go for the best plan. And it starts from the one which is obviously suggested by your query. So though not documented, to some extent indirectly it depends on the way you write the query, even when it is a cost-based optimizer. So that is one aspect. Sometimes creating an MVU, if the refresh frequency is tolerable in case of the corresponding execution corresponding where condition is very complex, may help you to improve on your query, improve on your execution performance of the query and things like that. So it is highly scenario specific thing, what exactly would work for you. These are some of the techniques which we try. Also looking for any kind of recursive operations which may be there. So basically you have to trace the execution statistics, and from that you know exactly what is the cause and how you can tune. But maybe partitioning will be a good option for you, provided your queries are normally for a particular range of data, and that will be your partitioning criteria then, if that is the case. If we describe the dual or dummy, it shows that the size is 1. If we write a query select Maruti from dual, it shows the entire text without any truncation. Now basically Maruti, this dual table is not our real table. This is a feature which has been put up, this dummy column. That's why the column name is dummy. This is basically put up because in Oracle everything is stored in the form of a table, and any result is returned in response to a SQL query which is fired on a table. That's why in order to facilitate any kind of mathematical operations or any kind of information about the various server or session variables, this dual table is given. It's a dummy table, it's not real table, and that's why it is possible, whereas for a normal table you are restricted by whatever is the column size. And as far as display is concerned, restricted by whatever is the maximum size of the value which is there in that column. What is bitmap index and how it works? Basically, Pramod, bitmap index is a special category of index which is quite different than our traditional indexes. It is actually a matrix where on one side you have a set of values and other side you have the corresponding rows, and in each cell there is either a 0 or 1. By default everything is 0. And say for example I have my EMP1 table. On the department table, department number, I have a bitmap index created and there are 3 departments. And in my table there are 10,000 rows. So I will have 10,000 rows in this bitmap index, and there will be 3 columns, one for each value of department, say 10, 20 and 30. Now my physically first row, the corresponding employee belongs to department number 10. Then for this particular row, in the cell which is coming, which is the intersection of department 10 column and this particular row number 1 of my bitmap index, there will be 1, rest of it will be 0. So any query which is fired with the condition where department number 10, where department number is equal to 10. With the help of this kind of bitmap index, it will be executed very quickly, because all it has to do is just search what are the cells which are having 1 for that particular column, and that corresponding rows are marked. So basically your search happens very fast with bitmap index, but then there are some restrictions on it as far as performance is concerned. Like basically bitmap index is useful when the cardinality is low for that column, that is the possible values are less, lots of values are repeated. That's why actually this was introduced, because traditional B-tree index does not perform well when you have lots of repeated values. And secondly, the column should not, the probability of adding a new value for the column altogether new, that is currently there are only 3 departments, 10, 20, 30, and then a few more are added, then rebuilding the bitmap takes quite a lot of time. So that is an expensive affair. So bitmap indexes are not very common for those tables which are changing very frequently. I mean those columns which are changing very frequently. How useful is bulk operation, and what exact when exactly are they used? Shruti, basically bulk operation is very useful as far as your execution efficiency is concerned, say for example, I want to insert 100 rows, which I'm going to pick up from some place, okay, say from another table or a collection, and I just want to dump them in another collection. Then rather than using our normal insert inside a loop, if I use a bulk operation, then it will be faster, because normally what happens is, see, your loop executes in a PLSQL code, which is executed by a PLSQL engine. Now inside the loop is the insert query that is passed on to SQL engine. So there are a lot of context switches between your PLSQL engine and SQL engine. So when you are using a bulk operation, basically this context switching is reduced. In one shot, it will pass on everything to the SQL engine, and hence there is a tremendous performance gain. How to delete the session generated in case of Oracle when one user accessing two schema objects? We get two sessions for one user. How to delete the session generated in case of Oracle when one user accessing two schema objects? We get two sessions for one user. You, Abhishek, actually, I'm not very sure exactly what you want to ask. Is your question related to how to terminate a current session when in the session some data access or data operations are happening? Then in that case, definitely the super user or anybody who is granted the authority by the super user can terminate the session. For each session, there is a unique process ID. Okay, so basically that particular process is killed, and it is not going to affect any other session where you are connected with the same username, because even though I connect from the same machine, say my current machine, and I'm using the credentials of same user Scott, and I'm having three different logins. Suppose concurrent logins allowed is three per user. So with the same user Scott, I'm having three different logins. Each of this is a independent session and they don't affect each other. I believe that was your question. In case it is something different, please put in more details in a separate question. How DBA decides the request for dummy user has particular permission on data? I mean, how he can decide user who has used dummy credentials? Will the actual user not use the dummy credentials? Basically, what I mean by a dummy user here is it is more relevant to Oracle when I'm using the term. In Oracle, basically, there is no separate concept of a user. Your user and your schema are equivalent. Okay. Now the schema, which has got all your set of business related table info. Okay. All the business info in set of various tables. Now obviously I don't want to share this schema username password to the application, to the front end application for connecting to database. So in case of Oracle, what you have to do is you have to create a separate user, which is equivalent to creating a schema. In that schema, there will not be anything. There will not be any objects, most probably. And that user will be basically given only restricted privilege on the objects belonging to your owner schema. So that is why we call those as dummy users or front end application dummy users. Now, what kind of users you want to be created? That is basically the responsibility of the functional database functional designer or database schema designer or the developers. Most of the times developers, the senior one out of the developers performs these operations, or there is a separate data administrator or a data designer or data architect. It is a responsibility of this person to pass on to user, pass on to DBA, how many such users you want to be created and what kind of system resource privileges are to be granted to these. As far as object privileges are concerned, it is a responsibility most of the times of the schema owner to allocate these privileges. Most prevalent access control model in database is discretionary. That is, the owner can decide whom, who will have what kind of access on the owner's objects. So most of the times it is the responsibility of the main backend functional developer to allocate the privileges over the schema, over the schema tables, or any views or any procedures functions which you have created in that particular schema. When insert statement is fired, which will be checked first, trigger or check constraint? Basically, when insert statement is fired, first the check constraint will be checked, okay, and then the corresponding trigger will be called. Preventing data duplication error by validating using the data from table itself when running an batch job processing and skipping the row insertion reduces performance. Any idea for the issue? Okay. You are preventing data duplication error by validating using the data from the table itself and you are running it in the form of a batch job. And skipping the row insertion reduces the performance. I'm not very sure, Ajit, which software you are using and which version, but in case it is Oracle and in case it is 10.1 plus, then definitely there is a solution for this. You can basically make use of the feature which was introduced in 10.1, that any kind of errors which are produced during this kind of batch processing are logged and the corresponding operations continue instead of rolling back. But I'm not very sure about what exact features are available in other all other databases. So if you're using Oracle 10.1 plus, then yes, you can definitely reduce this performance overhead which is caused because of the complete rollback. Particularly the overhead is too much when the error happens towards the end. Next question is, in front end, as you said, we should not use the actual credentials for connection string to avoid accessing the database from unknown person. If the permitted user has to connect to the database, then that permitted user also should use the same dummy credentials to access the database if permitted user uses. How that user will be recognized. Basically, Sarath, what I explained is not directly connecting to the database from any kind of graphical or command line interface. I essentially explained what is most common in all our business architectures, where an SQL query, where a connection to the database is made via your front-end code. And to make a connection, it has to give some kind of user credentials of the database user. So I was talking about these user credentials which are used by any front-end form to connect to your database. And what kind of users are created and things like that, the DBA can very well find out by making use of various data dictionary views. Which additional dummy user is created for particularly which form, that will be a part of your project documentation, and that is basically something which the backend team conveys to the front-end design team. Now, if you are asking about blocking a direct login to the database by this dummy user which is meant for application to connect to database, then the DBA can take care of that by making use of the login logout events which are there and basically writing triggers based on these events. Okay, the next, what is read-only schema, how we can create it? Basically, a read-only schema is something which is, which is a specialty of specific softwares, not very common to all the softwares, and you will have to use the specific software specific syntaxes for it, where the set of tables are only the corresponding reference tables and you don't want any modification to happen. A more common version of it, a read-only table, is a snapshot. Okay. Or in the modern versions, it is a materialized view where you have set the refresh frequency to never refresh. How can a database be accessed if the grants are not provided? How are databases hacked? Shruti, basically, database has to be accessed by the front-end forms for various kind of business operations. That is the reason why the data is stored. So denying any access to the data is not a solution. What we basically do is we try to have a segregation between the user credentials used by the front-end form and the business schema owner user, thereby giving only restricted access to the front-end, so that in case the front-end is manipulated, still the impact of the corresponding threat will be low on our database side. I think I have finished answering all the questions which are so far passed on to me, and we have already overshooted on the time. Any additional questions you can pose on the corresponding site, and I'll be answering them there. I could see even before the session some questions, a couple of questions there, and answered some of them. So in case later on you want to ask some questions or things like that, then basically you please post it on the site and I'll be answering. If you want any kind of a personalized help, then here are the contact details. Basically, she is our business head and she redirects the queries to us. So in case there are no further questions, we would conclude. And basically, I wish you all a very, very secure implementation for your databases so that we don't see any kind of data breach news related to your organizations. Thanks all of you for your time, and I hope the session is beneficial to you. So basically, I thank all of you as well as the Tech Geek team for giving me this opportunity to share all my views with you guys. Thanks a lot.